Hello and welcome to Logic Components. Yes, this is a remake of an old series on this channel. It's a little bit overdue, just by a couple of years, but well, now that I know the stuff even better, hopefully I'll be able to bring you a more informative and easier to understand kind of lesson. So yeah, do kick back and enjoy. You're watching episode 1, The Introduction. Hello once again and welcome to Logic Components. Now, let's have a little bit of an overview of what we're going to be doing in this entire series. This particular series is aimed at beginners. If you are entirely new to the subject and you want a gradual introduction to the entire concept, well, this series is for you. The whole idea of what I'm doing is to try and help you understand some basic concepts without burdening you with too much information. So yeah, if that's what you're looking for, then you're at the right place. So let's begin with our actual content. What are these logic components? Why do we need them? Well, if you take a look at your computer, you realize that, well, it's a bunch of electronics that have come together to do something very advanced. The components we'll be looking at are actually extremely low-level implementations that each have a little role in actually helping your computer think. In fact, your computer processor contains millions upon millions of transistors, and the whole idea is groups of these transistors come together to form what is known as a logic gate. But what do these gates actually do? Now, if you were to actually break down the concept of processing, you realize that it's not a very difficult flow. In particular, all you have to do is you take an input, you make a decision based on that input, and in doing so, you generate an output. That is literally all there is to any form of processing, from something as high level as, say, a game or word processor, to something as low level as just a single logic gate. The gates themselves don't deal with a whole lot of data. In fact, they actually only work with bits, that is, 0 or 1. Now, throughout this entire series, we'll be talking about bits a lot. You'll hear me using terms like 1 and 0, true and false, high and low, and these just refer to how data is represented in a computer. At its lowest level, data is really just represented by a current in a wire. Most of the time, the way information is actually conveyed on a wire is, well, by either having a high voltage or a low voltage. For example, a high voltage would represent a 1 or a true, depending on how you want to look at it, whereas a low voltage will represent a 0 or a false. In fact, all logic gates do is they take in a certain amount of bits as inputs, they actually look at these inputs to make a decision, and produce a 1-bit or multiple-bit output. So then you might be wondering, well, I have a whole lot of bits, fine, but what do I do with them? What kind of significance do they have in our actual computing? In fact, groups of bits can come together to actually form numbers. These numbers can then be used to represent other things, for example, values like characters, words, and even at a higher level, images, sound, and video. Now, I'm gonna tell you right now that this is slightly beyond the scope of this entire series. In order to make you understand, I do have to explain this a little bit, but this is going to be very much in brief, and there is a lot more to this subject. But yes, let's begin. The whole idea is, if you have a binary string that looks like this, this can actually represent a number. The way you figure out the number it represents is you actually start writing a bunch of weights. You start from the right and you write 1. Then you move 1 over to the left and you double the previous weight. So now you have 2. Move on once again, double the previous weight, you get 4. And then 8. And then 16, 32, 64, and so on. So the next thing you want to do is you want to take all the weights and multiply them by the binary digit they are on top of. So obviously if it's 0, we're just going to ignore it because it's going to be equal to 0. But if any one of them is 1, then we have to bring the value down. When we're done looking through the entire binary string, we can then take all the values and add them up. The answer to the addition is actually the number represented by the binary string. Now, as mentioned earlier, this is just the bare minimum. Well, there is a far more intuitive and easy to understand way of looking at this, but it will involve taking some amount of time to share it with you. If you're interested to find out more about this, I do recommend you check out a series called How to Count that I did some time ago. In that series, I actually go quite in depth about, you know, the intuitive method of understanding binary numbers and how you can count them the same way you would count your decimal numbers. And there you go. These are your few basic concepts you need to understand before, well, the entire series will start making sense. Once you get a grasp of just the entire environment in which all these gates and components actually work in, then you shouldn't have too much problem understanding how each individual one of them works. From the next episode on, we are actually going to just keep looking at component after component and understanding their own unique role. So here's a little roadmap of what's to come. We're going to start with the most basic, and that is the logic gates. The first three basic logic gates are your core concepts. In the episode after that, we're going to actually see what kind of modifications we can make to these gates, and we're going to create four more gates out of them. After we're comfortable with the idea of working with individual gates, what's going to happen is we're going to move on and we're going to start stringing multiple gates together, and we are going to start to see some basic thinking capability coming out of our circuits. We're also going to take a brief look at universal gates, and that is the idea of using just two logic gates to construct the rest of them. Beyond that point, we're going to take a look at some more complex components that begin to actually more closely mirror the things that you can do on your computer. We're going to start with multiplexers and demultiplexers, then we'll move on to encoders, decoders, and after that, we're going to actually look at memory-based components like latches and flip-flops. So that is very roughly the roadmap of what's to come. So yeah, that basically wraps it up for your first episode. I hope you are interested to find out more about this. Well, that's all I have for you today. I'll see you guys in a week. You're watching 0612 TV. Hello, thanks so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, remember that I appreciate every like, favorite, and comment you give me. If you'd like to see more from me in the future, don't forget to subscribe to this channel. And for more updates outside of YouTube, don't forget to follow me on Twitter at 0612TV. Once again, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.